From the world of politics to the world of business, this is Balance of Power with David Westin.
From Bloomberg World Headquarters in New York to our television and radio audiences worldwide, welcome to Balance of Power. It is Fed Day in America, and as we get ready for that big event coming up just 2 hours from right now, when we hear what the Fed's latest decision is, to be followed by the news conference from Chair Jay Powell, we set it up right now, get us all ready for it with Michael McKee. He's Bloomberg International Economics and Policy Correspondent, reporting once again from Washington. Michael?
Well, David, you know, Jay Powell makes a lot of comparisons to the Paul Volcker era. There's one big difference, and that is that in those days, the Fed didn't tell anybody what they were going to do. They didn't tell anybody what they did. Market watchers had to try to figure that out. But today, you got 19 members of the Open Market Committee running around talking all the time. Markets take that information, price it in. And by the time you get to Fed Day, there isn't much for me left to say, because we're looking at 75 basis points today. That's the market expectation, up to 4%. That's already priced in. They're not going to change balance sheet policy. Not a problem there. We don't get dots or a new economic forecast today. That'll be the December meeting. So the question is, will policymakers step down to 50 basis points at that December meeting? There's some feeling, there is a camp that says they should do that. They should take a look around. And then that leaves the question of how high do rates go and how fast do they get there? Will we get any information on those last two items from Powell at his news conference? Now, the argument that the Fed might want to start stepping down comes from this, the long and variable lags in monetary policy. You can see the white line there is the consumer price index. The blue line on top of it is the Fed funds rate. And you can see how long it takes after the Fed starts raising interest rates until inflation starts to come down. Now, the Fed has raised interest rates significantly this year. We'll be up 400 basis points by the end of the day. The question then is, will inflation start to come down quickly? And nobody knows. So that's an argument for caution going forward. Powell has to be careful, though, because he doesn't want to say anything too dovish, or the markets might go the other direction, might rally and work against the Fed. I do have one red line on here. You can see at the end, the bad news for the folks in Washington is that policy works with long and variable lags, and inflation is still very high a week before the midterms.
Okay, Michael, he does have a hot, tough job today, Chair Jay Powell. Thank you so much. That's Bloomberg's Michael McKee. Mike is going to be part of our special Fed coverage beginning at 1:30 p.m. Eastern time right here. Now we turn to somebody who has to deal with some of the higher costs of borrowing. He's Phil Murphy, governor of the state of New Jersey. So, Governor, thank you. We always love having you. I want to talk about midterms, but before that, strikes me, you have some experience at Goldman Sachs. You know a little bit about the way the markets work. How are the higher interest rates affecting New Jersey right now? Your borrowing costs must be going up.
They are, although we've been very opportunistic over the past 5 years to defease and pay down a lot of debt and a lot of debt avoidance. So it is clearly, I'm far more concerned about the impact at somebody's kitchen table than I am right now on our balance sheet. And I don't think the Fed has any choice. These are factors that are beyond our control, whether it's COVID relief or a war in Europe. There's no other choice but to be aggressive and do a Paul Volcker here and get out ahead of this.
Well, I'm so glad you put it that way, Governor, because I was curious, because you have seen it from both sides. You know the way the markets work. You also know what it means for the state. We have some of your fellow Democrats now are writing to Chair Jay Powell saying, you know, you're going too far, too fast. It's going to hurt us too much. You come down on the side of it's painful, but it needs to be done. Is that correct?
I'm afraid that is correct, and that I don't say that lightly, because the pain is significant at the kitchen table. It's a weird, David, you and I have talked about this, it's a weird economy. We have our lowest unemployment rate ever, below the national average. Our revenues at the state level continue to be solid. We've been upgraded three times this year by credit rating agencies. We've paid debt down, as I mentioned, and yet at the same time, there's enormous pain at that kitchen table, largely due to affordability.
And Governor, is that pain you think being felt as people go to the polls in New Jersey for these midterms? Because that might spell some not very good news for Democrats.
Well, we'll see. I mean, you've got the normal reality of a midterm election with an incumbent party in the White House. So you begin in a tough place, and then you add to that recovering from a pandemic, inflation, affordability. It won't make the races any easier. I am heartened by the quality of our incumbents and candidates. And I think there's no comparison in most of these races. And secondly, I think we've, as a party, beginning with the president, we've done a lot. We're probably not getting as much credit as we should get, but we've done a lot, whether it's the Inflation Reduction Act in New Jersey. We had a $2 billion historic property tax relief program, unlike anything ever before. And God willing, the folks on the ballot next week will get credit for some of that.
Tell us about the process of voting in New Jersey. There's a lot of concern about voter security, election place security around the country. You've seen some of the reports, for example, out of Arizona. What is the situation in New Jersey? Are you beefing up some of the security around polling places?
Yeah, thank God, David. Our story on elections and voting is counter almost completely to the narrative that you just alluded to. We have stood for opening up democracy since day one. So if you want to vote in New Jersey, you've got the ability to show up next Tuesday, and we'll make sure that's safe and secure. We've had no issues at all. You can vote by mail. Just get your ballot in by election, postmarked election night. Or thirdly, beginning last year, we have in-person early voting, and that's going really well. I think we're up 25% over our first year last year. So thank God we don't have, we stand for opening up democracy. We stand for transparency, and I'm knocking on wood, so far, so good in New Jersey.
Governor, what position does crime place on the ballot in New Jersey at this point? We had that terrible shooting just overnight in Newark of two police officers. First of all, how are they doing? And what does that say more largely about the problem with violence and crime in New Jersey?
Yeah, largely good news with those blessed heroes. One of them has been discharged. I'll speak with him on the phone later. One is in the hospital, but stable. I will see him later this afternoon. And even better news, David, within the past half an hour, they've caught the guy, the bad guy. So you've got an interesting, the Republicans, bless their hearts, are really good at playing the crime card. And they're playing it really well again in this election. And there's no doubt crime is an issue in our state. The biggest challenge we've had are car thefts, but violent crimes are down meaningfully. Shootings are down meaningfully. Homicides are down meaningfully. When I say meaningfully, in all those cases, somewhere between 15 and 30%. So again, the political discourse versus the reality. And the other thing I'd like to get off my chest is if you're going to be anti-crime, you can't just be anti some crimes. So, I mean, the reaction to Paul Pelosi's very severe injuries is shameful among, unfortunately, a whole lot of Republicans on the ballot. We're either all in this together to make America safe, or we're playing political games. And sadly, there's a lot of the latter.
Governor, you raised the question of taxes a bit earlier here. Let's talk about taxes, particularly, I think it's called the employer convenience tax, something like that. Where does that sit with people who are living and working in New Jersey, but with New York employment? Where does that sit right now?
It's a good question. We challenged at the Supreme Court level. There was a New Hampshire versus Massachusetts case, and we were unsuccessful. So we're trying to find a way. And by the way, we get along with New York. I'm a huge fan of Governor Hochul and Mayor Adams. We do so much together. We root for each other's success. But it's a question of fairness. If you're paying full freight in the old traditional reality of going commuting into work every day, when in fact you're in a hybrid reality today, that's just not fair. So where does it stand? It is still in process. No news to make. But there's a question of fairness that I hope we can achieve sooner than later.
You mentioned your cooperation with the state of New York, and we saw that through the pandemic with Kathy Hochul's predecessor, Mr. Cuomo. You'd always cooperated closely. Now it looks like she may have a tough race for herself in New York. How would that shift, do you think, Governor, if in fact it's Lee Zeldin rather than Kathy Hochul?
I don't want to speculate on what that would look like, other than to say I'm a huge fan of Kathy Hochul. She and I spoke the other night. We were texting last night. She's in a tough race again. We got 36 governor's races in addition to the whole House and a third of the Senate. And this is that classic midterm reality. But she's done a heck of a job in, and talk about a battlefield promotion. She's really impressive. We do a lot together. God willing, she will win this.
Governor, I'm going to break all the rules here and sneak in one more because we got a request from a New Jersey resident, one of your constituents here. It says, where do you stand on mandatory COVID, COVID mandates for police, firemen, and medical workers? That's from a viewer.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I think we've been able to thread the needle throughout the entire COVID reality, and that's in the context. We're a state that was clobbered. 34,000 precious lives lost. We want to get the balance right, though. I think we've always been able to strike that between public health and on the one hand and public safety on the other hand. And I think we've been able to do that.
Great. Governor, it's always such a pleasure and really helpful to have you on. Thank you for your time. That's New Jersey Governor Phil Murphy. Coming up, we're going to talk with the ranking member of the House Intelligence Committee, Mike Turner, about what the midterm elections could mean for U.S. support for the Ukraine. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and on radio. Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. I'm David Westin. To keep up to date with news for all around the world, we turn now to Lisa Mateo here with the first word.
Thank you, David. Well, Russia has agreed to resume taking part in the Black Sea grain export deal. The Kremlin says it has received written guarantees from Ukraine that the safe package corridor will be used only for shipping grain. The agreement is seen as critical for shoring up world food supplies. It's decision day at the Federal Reserve, and for a fourth straight time, policymakers are expected to raise interest rates by a supersized 75 basis points to the highest level since 2008. Meanwhile, Fed Chair Jerome Powell is likely to stick to his message that the hottest inflation in 40 years must be tamed. The man who killed 17 students and staff at a Parkland, Florida high school will be sentenced to life in prison today. Nicholas Cruz pleaded guilty to the 2018 attack last year. Last month, a jury decided against the death penalty and chose a life sentence without the possibility of parole. A judge will formally sentence Cruz today. The embattled owner of the Washington Commanders has hired Bank of America to consider a potential sale of the NFL team. Dan Snyder has been surrounded by controversy for years, including complaints about a toxic workplace culture. Last month, the owner of the Indianapolis Colts said the NFL should consider removing Snyder from his role and force him to sell the franchise. Global news 24 hours a day on air and on Bloomberg Quick Take, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Lisa Mateo. This is Bloomberg. David.
Thank you so much, Lisa. Well, we're 6 days away now from those midterm elections, and we don't know what the results will be, but there are a lot of people who are predicting that the Republicans may regain a majority in the House. We welcome now someone whose job might change if that happened. He's Republican Congressman Mike Turner of Ohio. He's the ranking member of the House Intelligence Committee. So, Congressman, thank you so much for being with us.
David, thank you for having me.
I don't want to get ahead of the polls. I know you don't either, but just in case the Republicans did get a majority, what difference would it make in your life? What difference would it make on the Intelligence Committee, for example?
Right. The Intelligence Committee itself has very, very important functions that go right to the heart of our national security. And our goal will be to return the committee back to its national security functions and goals, to be a resource for intelligence in Congress for policymaking and decision making. You know, we were hijacked by the impeachment processes before that both divided the committee and gave a very partisan environment. Our focus will be, we have some real adversaries who are self-identified and they're targeting the United States. How can we make certain that our national security is safe and that our allies are strong?
Well, I'm really interested that that's your answer, because one of the questions I was going to ask you is, I can imagine a world in which the Republicans take over and say, OK, we've got it now. Let's do a bunch of investigations the way the Democrats did a lot of investigations. It's never clear to me what comes out of those investigations. Are you saying you'd avoid things like Hunter Biden and things like that?
Well, certainly in the Intelligence Committee. Now, there are components of those, obviously, that go to abuses in the intelligence community, and those have to have oversight by the Intelligence Committee itself. But the more partisan, those things that are charged, I think there are committees that will take those up. But our focus is going to be more on governance. How do we get this economy back on track, lower inflation, make certain our border is secure, make certain that we're responding to our adversaries. That's going to be our primary focus.
And what about Ukraine? I mean, I know you've just been to Ukraine recently. Yes. You've been over there. You've talked with President Zelensky, not the first time. You've been clear, as Kevin McCarthy, your minority leader, has said, we got to avoid waste. We can't have a blank check.
Absolutely.
I get that. I think everybody gets that. But can you identify waste thus far in some of the money that's been appropriated and sent over to Ukraine?
Sure, absolutely. And intuitively, people get this. So, when I was sitting across from President Zelensky. He asked the same question. And I said, you know, well, we're not going to pass a $40 billion bill to get $8 billion to Ukraine. And he knows what that's happened. You know, all of the headlines were $40 billion bill. Ukraine got a very, very small portion of that. The other aspect is humanitarian aid. We take weapon systems and we give them directly to Ukraine. We actually take our humanitarian aid and we give it to the United Nations. Already that is a cut that happens in the aid that goes to Ukraine. And their processes are not the most successful. We have a functioning sovereign government that we can provide aid to. Humanitarian aid needs to go directly to them, not through the United Nations.
Let me ask a different question here that would be very pertinent, I think, if the Republicans take over, and that's the debt ceiling. We've got a debt ceiling that we're going to be bumping up against, and there's a lot of reporting, including from Bloomberg, that perhaps the Republicans would hold that hostage to get some other reforms that might be good reforms or bad reforms. At the same time, President Biden has warned that would be really chaotic. This is what President Biden had to say.
They're going to shut down the government by not providing the votes to pay our federal debt to other countries in the world. This is irresponsible. Nothing would create more chaos and do more damage to the American economy than playing around with whether we pay our national bills.
Congressman, your response.
Well, what's been dangerous for American economy is the out-of-control spending from the Biden administration that has resulted in this, what will be years-long inflation that we're dealing with, and these recessionary pressures that are going to result from these increases in interest rates. What the president needs to do is come to the table and negotiate with Republicans, because if we win in November, either the House or the House and the Senate, he's no longer going to have, in effect, the blank check for himself and for his party's goals. That spending is going to have to be tamped down in order to lower inflation for families who are trying to put food on the table. And certainly, that means he's going to have to negotiate. The Obama administration did not do that very well, resulted in a couple government shutdowns. I think President Biden has to understand this economy needs attention, and we're going to be his partner in doing that.
You've mentioned inflation, and goodness knows that's on voters' minds. We hear that every poll we see, it's about inflation. What can the Republicans do if they gain majority in the House? Is it a matter of stopping new legislation and new spending, or are there affirmative things that can be done?
There are affirmative things that can be done, but it is stopping new spending. I mean, what has happened with the Biden administration spending, especially with their post-COVID act, there are, you know, billions of dollars that are in state legislators and local governments that have not yet been spent. They're going to be spent over the next several years and certainly provide inflationary pressures. At the same time, you have the infrastructure bill. Those billions haven't been spent. The president's attempt at setting aside student debt, those would have inflationary pressures. It's trying to get us back to how do we fund the functions of government that are necessary, our national defense, our security, and how do we get this economy working again, our supply chain working again. That will make a big impact also on inflation.
Congressman, it's great having you here. Thank you so much for taking the time and dropping by. That is Ohio Congressman Mike Turner. Coming up, we're going to go to Arizona and talk with University of Arizona Professor Samara Klar about the tight races for Senate and for governor out there. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and on radio. Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. I'm David Weston. We continue to focus on those midterm elections 6 days from now. And one of the key states is Arizona, where there's a very tight race in the Senate to try to take out the incumbent, Mark Kelly, the Democrat, and also a fairly interesting race for governor. We welcome now somebody who knows Arizona backwards and forwards. She's Samara Klar, professor at the University of Arizona's School of Public Policy. So, Professor, thanks so much for being back with us. Give us your take on where we are right now in the Senate and the governor's races in particular. Do we know?
Sure. We have another election here in Arizona where we don't know who's going to win. Both the governor race and the Senate race are so close. Kelly, the Democratic senator, current Democratic senator, has had a pretty consistent lead, but it's narrowing. And in some polls, it's no longer outside the margin of error. Lake and Hobbs are two very different candidates for governor, also are at this really tight race. Rarely do I see either candidate outside the margin of error, although for that race, it's the Republican candidate, Lake, who's been gaining a little bit in the polls.
And what about the early voting? As I recall, last time we talked to you, there's a lot of early voting. There's a tradition there in Arizona. How's it going?
Absolutely. Arizonans love to early vote. In the last election, about 90% of voters mailed in their ballots. So we're going to see another huge early voting turnout with mail-in ballots going in. What this means is it I would be surprised if we knew the outcome of this election on election night, given how close it is and how many ballots there are to count. I would expect a couple days before we have any final results out of here.
Any disputes thus far about the security of the process? Because there's a lot of that, as you know, Professor, all around the country now. People are raising questions.
Well, in Arizona, it's been a big issue because, you know, the Republicans here in Arizona were fighting the electoral results in 2020. We had a huge audit, which really brought a lot of attention to our state and particularly to our Democratic governor, candidate for governor, Katie Hobbs, who was sort of overseeing that audit. There's been so many assurances to the people of Arizona that the election here is secure, that there's no issues with electoral integrity. So that's what we're going off of. And I think at this point, we've got some pretty solid evidence that every vote is going to count.
The Hispanic vote is terribly important in Arizona, as in other states as well. Do we have any sense about how that may be turning out? Because as we know, some people think that this is a key election to decide whether the Democrats start losing their Hispanic support.
Yeah, absolutely. Here in Arizona, the Hispanic vote constitutes about 25% of our electorate. So that's a real big chunk of our voters. Hispanic voters in Arizona tend to break for the Democrats about 2-1. It's about 65% of Arizona Hispanic voters tend to vote for the Democrat. But what we've seen in recent polls is that Hispanic Americans in Arizona are very concerned about, as you would guess, inflation. And Hispanics are split about 50-50 as to whether the Republican or Democratic parties will be better for inflation. So that could chip away at the Democrats' advantage with Hispanic voters. But if it has been consistent over time, we should see Democrats gaining most of the support among Hispanic voters. But I mean, only time will tell.
Professor, for those of us who are not in Arizona, like you're in Arizona, it's hard to tell sometimes what's going on. We see a lot about possible voter intimidation with some people with weapons and masks on and things. There's a lawsuit, I know, that's been brought to try to curb that. Is that widespread? Do you have an impression of that? Or are we just seeing some limited video? Because I don't know.
My impression is that's the exception rather than the norm. As I said, most Arizonans are not actually showing up to the ballot place at all. They're mailing in their ballots. The reason we're seeing this in the media is because it's so unusual. It's so extreme. But I don't think it really sort of illustrates how typically the vote is going here in Arizona, where most people are dealing with early ballots, mail-in ballots. Voter intimidation is, of course, awful when it happens, and it should be in the media, but it sort of represents the exception rather than the norm.
Professor, really, you are so terrific at bringing us up to speed on what's going on in voting in Arizona. Thank you. That is Professor Samara Klar of the University of Arizona. Coming up, we're going to talk with former Fed Vice Chair Alan Blinder about what we should expect from the Fed just over 90 minutes from right now, actually, as the Fed comes out with this decision, to be followed by that news conference with the chair of the Fed. He is Jay Powell. That's coming up on Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio.
Welcome back. You're watching Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. European equity markets are closing down for the day, down being the operative word. We've been fading really since the get-go this morning. However, I think the ADP print out of the United States certainly gave us further cause to head lower as we've come through into the close. So main European markets down by, let's call it circa 0.5%. The CAC40 in Paris down a little bit more. Let me just show you the trajectory of the day. Clearly today is really all about the Fed. That is going to be the main pivot point around which global markets are going to be operating. The Stock 600 trading down through 413, trading down towards 413, down through 413, down around 0.3%. But as I say, a fade throughout most of the day. The ADP print, probably the single factor that kind of worked against us this afternoon. And obviously that feeds into what's happening with the Fed and the employment number come Friday. In terms of how the sector story has broken down, let's take you through the GRR, the sector breakdown story. Healthcare doing well today, telecoms doing well, utilities doing well today, energy fairly mixed. But basically what that tells you, those three sectors, is that this market has a defensive bias today, a more cautious market. Those are the safe havens here in Europe. The bottom end of the market, we see a fade in the luxury goods sector. We see a fade as well in the basic resources sector. That's the commodities trade. That's copper, iron, zinc, aluminium, all that kind of stuff. This, as this China reopening trade, which we saw earlier on this week, just starts to fade out of the market a little bit. We head towards the Fed. Let's talk about some of the individual stocks as well. We are watching clearly the earnings numbers continue to trickle through. But the macro story coming from the earnings story is significant. AP Moller-Maersk
is the world's second biggest shipping line. It ships containers, big boxes. It has a pretty good idea of what is happening with the global economy. Søren Skou, the CEO of the Danish-based firm, talking about the fact that Europe probably already is in recession and the United States probably isn't too far behind. You could also take maybe that signal away from Wizz Air, one of Europe's low-cost carriers. It was expecting to have a more solid winter season. It's now withdrawing some of that optimism. And that again tells you what's happening with the consumer in Europe. Maybe the propensity to spend beginning to fade a little bit. And then we come to Vestas, which is a really interesting story. This is the huge turbine maker. This is part of the green revolution that we're talking about so often. And the impact going forward from here is going to be enormous. These companies have really struggled with supply chain bottlenecks, and they've been struggling with high materials costs as well. Obviously, huge turbines take an awful lot of materials to build them. Now, today's numbers actually weren't that great, but it's the outlook. Maybe some of those supply chain bottlenecks are beginning to fade out of the system, and that ultimately probably is good news going forward here from Vestas. This is a huge industry and is going to have to grow significantly from here, but it's been held back by shortages we've seen with the bottlenecks and with the materials. Quick wrap up of what we're seeing stateside right now. What's happening on Wall Street, significant as well as we head towards the Fed very, very shortly. The S&P is down by around 0.7%, trading at 38.28. You've got a US 2-year yield, 4.54 right now, a little bit into the bond market going into the Fed. In terms of the corporate news, Airbnb significant as well. Again, maybe that message coming from the travel sector when it comes to the discretionary spend starting to fade a little bit, particularly as well. People used to, during the pandemic and after the pandemic, go to places like Lake Tahoe and enjoy the countryside there and basically work from home. That story is beginning to fade. They're going back to the more traditional one night, two night. And that, again, just tells you about where the consumer is at the moment. AMD, though, much more positive picture. That stock up by 1.72%, now trading at 60.69. We are seeing the PC fade, but what we are seeing is the cloud computing business doing fairly well. And it's that balance that seems to be working just in AMD's favor right now. But David, as I say, it's all about the Fed. That's the main event. That's what all these markets are looking at.
It is, Guy. But thank you so much. That was a real tour de force of summing up both Europe and the United States. And let's come back to the Fed now, because as Guy said quite correctly, it is all about the Fed. And we turn now to someone who knows the Fed, including from the inside. Alan Blinder is professor of economics at Princeton, and he served as the vice chair of the Federal Reserve. He is most recently the author of A Monetary and Fiscal History of the United States, 1961 to 2021. So, Professor, thank you so much for being with us. I mean, I can ask you what the Fed's going to do, but we're going to know that in a little less than 90 minutes now. We could argue about it. We could look it up. But let me ask you this. Which is more important to communicate something about? Is it the pace of the raising rates, or is it the ultimate destination?
I think at this point it's the ultimate destination. I mean, they both matter, and they're related, of course, in the sense that, you know, unless your destination is in the stratosphere, you need to slow down from 75 basis points per meeting fairly soon, not today. I mean, we do know what they're going to do today. They're going to go up 75 basis points. The key thing is the atmospherics, what Jay Powell says about it, or maybe what the FOMC says about it in the statement, but I think much more what Jay Powell says about it in the press conference.
I wonder, Professor, and again, you were vice chair of the Fed. You know it terribly well. Are we asking too much of the Fed at this point? We're asking them to deal with inflation and unemployment and financial stability. Is it too much pressure? We had Mohammed Al-Erian, you know him well, on Bloomberg earlier, and this is what he said about that problem.
The discussion with the politicians has to be, well, you can help on the employment side. Labor force participation should be going up. It's not. So we need to enlarge this conversation to bring in more tools. Otherwise, it's going to be this awful trilemma where is it inflation, is it jobs, is it financial stability?
So what do you think about the professor? Is he right? We need some help from the political side of this?
Yes, I think he's right, although I would change the verb away from need. I wrote this whole monetary history that you mentioned at the beginning. The fiscal branch is often not very helpful to the monetary branch, and the Fed is kind of used to going it alone. I mean, what Mohammed said about labor force participation is right. That would be great if something could be done about that. But the Fed Fed does not assume it's going to get a lot of help from the White House or from the Congress, and it has these responsibilities for inflation, employment, and financial stability. that he mentioned, and it understands that, and you know that's part of the job description. You know, the joke line is that's what they pay them the big bucks for. They actually get paid small bucks, but you know that's the joke line.
Yeah, I understand. They're public servants, though. So let me ask you: as you sit around that table with the governors and hash this out, and the economic data doesn't all point in one single direction, at least not that I can identify. There's conflicting data. There's a lot of discussion about: is the risk to the upside or the downside? That is to say, is the bigger risk that we do too little on inflation, let it get out of control, or we do too much and turn us into a recession? Do they have that discussion around that table?
Oh, yeah, I'm sure they're about almost finished now, but they've had that discussion at great length and in great detail. Why do I say that? Everybody knew before they walked into the meeting that the Fed was going up 75 basis points this time. And everybody knew also that the markets and other experts that pay attention to the Fed, by the way, we should remember that most people don't pay attention to the Fed, but Bloomberg watchers do. And they knew that the attention was going to be on what kind of forward guidance the Fed would give. And that comes exactly to your question. Where are the risks? Are we more worried that the Fed, that the economy is going to take a dip, a dive that the Fed doesn't want? Or are we more worried that inflation is going to roll on unchecked? I think the worry right now, remember, with these 75 basis points, we're only about 4%. On the funds rate. I think the biggest risk right now is the latter. The Fed is still worried about inflation, which is just stubbornly high.
And yet the markets, if anything, seem to be pointing the other direction. The last 2 weeks, conditions have been loosening. And to some extent, the market seems to be running away from Jay Powell and the Fed. What do you do about that if you're the Fed?
Well, if you're worried about that, I don't think he is actually, but if you're worried about that, you growl a bit. You know, that's what Jay Powell did in Jackson Hole. The markets were, as is their wont, running away from reality a bit, that time on the dovish side, and he reined them back in. If he thinks that's the case now, he'll rein them back in again. I don't really think that's the case now. The market is looking intelligently, and they should be looking for what's gotten to be called a pivot point. That is, when is the Fed going to stop going up in 75 basis point increments? That's got to be pretty soon. Maybe not today, but if not today, the next meeting. And I think there's a reasonable chance it will be today. That is the last of the 75s, but not the last of the rate hikes.
And finally, Professor, I saw you said recently that you think there still is a narrow, narrow path towards so-called soft landing. Let me give you another alternative, which is stagflation. What's the risk of stagflation at this point for us?
Well, I think there is a risk of stagflation, and they're very much related. That the thing that's going to prevent a soft landing, I think, is not a Fed error. That's possible, but it's not the top of my culprit list. It's the behavior of oil and food prices. And those are the classic causes of stagflation. If food prices take another leg up and oil prices take another leg up, remember OPEC is lurking in the background. It's going to be extremely difficult to land this craft softly. Very difficult.
Okay, Professor, it's always such a treat to have you with us. Thank you for the time and the wisdom. That's Alan Blinder. He's professor of economics at Princeton. Coming up, Israel held its fifth election in 4 years. We'll go over the likely results with Aaron David Miller of the Carnegie Institute for International Peace. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and on radio. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. I'm David Westin. Well, Israel has had now its fifth election in 4 years. And as of right now, it looks like Bibi Netanyahu will be returned, actually be prime minister yet again, although the government might look quite differently with the coalition that he'll put together. To take us through what is going on in Israel with this election, we welcome now Aaron David Miller. He is senior fellow at the Carnegie Institute for International Peace and is the author of The Much Too Promised Land, America's Elusive Search for Arab-Israeli Peace. So thank you so much for being with us. First of all, is it pretty clear that Bibi Netanyahu will be the prime minister?
I think 97% of the votes have been counted, other than double ballots belonging to civilians serving abroad, soldiers, individuals in hospitals, and a number of others, looks pretty clear. There are two parties that have yet to fully come in, and if they cross the threshold, Mr. Netanyahu may lose a seat or two. But it looks like he's in a position for the first time in, as you put it, 4 years. It's not Bill Murray and Groundhog Day now. He's going to put together a government with either 62 to 65 seats.
Okay, what does he do with it? Do we have any sense of where this heads and how different it will be from what we've seen in the past?
Well, I think it's going to be very different than the coalition we saw over the course of the last year, which represented a more or less a coalition of left, center, and right. This is going to be a very, this is clearly the most hardline, most right-wing government in the history of the state of Israel. In fact, it's in that respect, it's an inflection point. Israel's never had a government in which a significant party, the religious Zionism, has members and representatives, who a couple of which will become ministers, who openly avow a racist, homophobic, and supremacist point of view. And it's led by a 46-year-old provocateur, very charismatic, very popular, by the name of Itamar Ben-Gvir. And Mr. Netanyahu wanted this coalition. He wanted the right wing, extreme right wing, in it in order to cross the 60 plus three threshold so that he could pass legislation which would either defer, postpone, or indeed cancel his indictments. He's on trial for fraud, bribery, and breach of trust. And I think the main takeaway on the domestic side is that you're going to see an effort by this government through legislation to handicap, undermine, and constrain the independent judiciary in Israel. It's a serious threat, I think, to Israel's democratic character. How it will change in foreign policy is not entirely clear, but I wouldn't bet a lot of money that you're going to have a smooth and seamless relationship with the Biden administration, even though both Netanyahu and Biden will go to great lengths, I think, to avoid a confrontation. They're too busy. They have too much else to do.
That's the Biden administration. What about the Arab neighbors of Israel at this point? What about Saudi Arabia? What about the people who participated in the Abraham Accords? What does it mean for the Palestinians, for that matter, on the West Bank?
Yeah, David, that's a critical point. You know, Netanyahu fashions himself, along with Jared Kushner, to be the father, the midwife of the Abraham Accords. So I think his relationships with the UAE and his putative relationship with Saudi Arabia and personal relationship with Mohammed bin Salman, a.k.a. MBS, will act as something of a constraint. Because if he pushes too far against the Palestinians in the West Bank or against Palestinian citizens of Israel, he's going to run into heavy water with the Arabs. So I think that will serve as a constraint, as will the most recently concluded maritime boundary agreement between Israel and Lebanon, which will allow both sides to exploit natural gas in the Eastern Med. But how this is going to go with Mr. Ben-Gvir, whose agenda and platform calls for expelling Arabs, undermining, if not dismantling, the Palestinian Authority, is unclear. As I said before, Mr. Netanyahu enabled, created this coalition. Now he's going to have to live with it.
It's always great to have a true expert on. Thank you so much. That was very good. Aaron David Miller, senior fellow at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Coming up, we go to the White House to get the latest on cybersecurity from Deputy National Security Advisor Ann Neuberger. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. I'm David Westin. Well, cybersecurity is something on the mind of Global Wall Street every single day. And right now, there's a summit going on at the White House. I want to get the title right here. It's the Second International Counter-Ransomware Summit. And we turn now to the person who has organized that. She is Ann Neuberger, Deputy National Security Advisor for Cyber and Emerging Technology at the National Security Council. So, Ann, thank you so much for being with us. I understand this is the second one, although the first one that is not virtual, right? Tell us what you're trying to accomplish.
Absolutely. So the president knows that cybercrime ransomware is an issue affecting Americans' pocketbooks, companies, civilians, people who don't feel safe online, as well as, of course, some of our critical infrastructure. So he's really made it a priority. And we've accomplished a lot over the last year, working with other countries to arrest criminals, particularly those overseas, launching a website, stopransomware.gov, to give good security advice, and then working to track and counter the illicit movement of funds through the cryptocurrency ecosystem. But fundamentally, cybercrime and ransomware are an international problem. You have criminals sitting in one country using malware or infrastructure in a whole set of other countries attacking targets in the United States and around the world. So as such, we convened 36 countries and the European Union to say, what more do we need to do together to counter this threat? And we identified a set of very specific outcomes to get after it.
So, Anne, as you know, in business, it's often said, and this is my personal experience, actually, if you can't measure it, you cannot manage it. So I guess my question is, how do you measure progress here? I mean, I see that I think that banks basically report to the Treasury Department, and they're reporting something like $1 billion, maybe, of ransomware being paid. Do you measure how much is being paid? Do we know how much is being paid?
That's a great question. As you said, you know, we are getting those reports, so we have a sense of what's being paid. But what we heard from countries around the world is generally, as governments, we don't have as much insight as we want into it. So we're really focused first, among all, on stopping it and getting at the components, the criminals, the infrastructure. And like I said, it's a money-driven problem. So the illicit movement of cryptocurrency, that's often the ransom payments that are being made. And as a result, so the way we talked about getting after it was first, standing up a platform to share information rapidly between countries about those three factors I talked about. Second, launching in the first quarter of next year a joint operational task force to bridge across the information we have about criminals, the money that's funding it, and the infrastructure, the computers and servers that are being used to launch this malware. And finally, collaborating on some of the national policies around ransom payments, around the role insurance companies can play, both helpful and potentially less so, and working across governments to put that in place to really get after the threat.
So it sounds, Anne, like a lot of that is on the defense to try to defend against it, which goodness knows is important to do, critical to do. At the same time, some experts I talked to saying, you know what, you can't really beat cyber attacks through defense. You have to go after the bad actors. Can you make real
Absolutely.
Progress in a summit like this without, for example, I'll pick a name at random, Russia involved? Because a lot of this seems to originate from Russia.
That's a really great point. And I think when we talk about going on the offense, there are different ways to go after the offense. One part I mentioned are the arrests of cyber criminals, and those are not in the United States. So during our discussions, a number of examples were used of partnerships with countries like Bulgaria and Canada and recent arrests that were made of individuals who are cyber criminals in this space. Second, the movement of money. You know, you've seen from a Treasury perspective, we sanctioned some cryptocurrency ecosystems and mixers that were used to launder the money. And finally, infrastructure. We can use law enforcement tools and others to take down infrastructure. So there are ways we can really act effectively in an offensive way, in creative and innovative ways. We've done that in the US. We've done it to a more limited extent with other countries. And the purpose and why the White House brought these countries together was to say, let's double down and be even more active on it.
There's a lot of talk, Anne, as you know, of private-public partnerships when it comes to infrastructure, when it comes to energy, things like that. What about public partnerships when it comes to cybersecurity? We've got some of the best, I think, technical minds in the world, in the United States, and some of the other Western countries. Are they fully enlisted in this effort?
Great point. So this was the first time we involved the private sector in the meeting. We brought in 12 companies from around the world, global companies, to listen to them and to hear from them what they believed they could do in the fight and what we could do together. It was just the start. We're going to continue those conversations with private sector firms. But we had internet service providers. We had new technology firms. We had cybersecurity firms. And we had firms who build tech, who we are encouraging to really put security at the fore as they build new tech, bringing them into the conversation because you're so right. This isn't a government issue, it's a private sector government issue. And to that point, we talked a lot, I know you mentioned earlier with defense, of really the requirements we're starting, the Biden administration and President Biden and the Vice President are actively involved in laying in requirements on specific critical sectors. So we have a minimum baseline of cybersecurity practices in place, so they're harder targets against these criminals.
Anne, really great to have you with us. Thank you for spending the time with us. That's Anne Neuberger. She's Deputy National Security Advisor for Cyber and Emerging Technology at the National Security Council. Check out the Balance of Power newsletter on the terminal and online. And this is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio.